This is Bea Haber with Modern Albuquerque. You're listening to U.S. Modernist Radio.
Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Oh, I don't care what mama don't allow, gonna draw mine modern anyhow. Mama don't allow no architecture around here.
Welcome to U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. One of the most successful architecture firms in the world is largely unknown to the public, and unless you're a design professional, Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, or SOM, sounds like a law firm your Uncle Mitch might work at.
Yeah.
SOM has created international airports, stunningly tall skyscrapers, universities, flagship museums, and landmark corporate headquarters since the 1930s. Today, we talk about SOM with Nick Adams, author of Gordon Bunshaft and SOM, Building Corporate Modernism, and architectural historian and design writer Kate Regev. And now, the guy who used to think that massing was something that happened after a big meal, Mr. Modernism, George Smart.
Hi, folks. Massing, spelled M-A-S-S-I-N-G. Use in a sentence. After Tom and I ate all the turkey and stuffing and potatoes and green beans and fried chicken and cranberry sauce and ice cream and sweet tea and apple pie, we all started massing.
Yeah.
However, in architecture, this word means making small models or drawings of a building, showing the shapes of the sections and how they relate to each other.
Oh.
If you get this part wrong, there goes your Pritzker Prize, the Heisman Trophy of architecture. One guy that pretty much always aced the massing part was Gordon Bunshaft, one of the stars of SOM who was awarded a Pritzker Prize in 1988. Along with Bunshaft were other, more hidden figures, such as Natalie Dubois and Norma Sklarek. Support for U.S. Modernist Radio comes from Nichiha.com/U.S. Modernist, and modernist realtor Angela Roll.
In an adventure we are largely making up, Angela Roll was in the CIA science lab washing beakers from another day of converting Nutella into jet fuel when suddenly a beaker of the thick, sweet, brown goo broke, cutting her arm and covering her in highly classified chemicals, not even available on the deep web. As a warm glow came over her and soft violin theme music mysteriously began to play, she realized she had a superhero origin story. As she passed modernist houses, Angela instantly knew the right market value of each house, including how to fix them up. And now she had superpowers as Captain Modern.
Captain Modern.
Angela could predict modernist sales pricing with laser focus.
Pew, pew, pew.
And sometimes there was house damage because of those lasers. Although she was ridiculed by other superheroes who could fly or be invisible or shoot lasers out of their eyes, Angela put her powers to work closing sale after sale, combining her architecture training, which is a real thing, and advising modernist buyers and sellers on pricing strategy and how to bid on the prices right and win.
Yes.
Angela Roll is your special agent. Reach her at angelaroll.com. That's R-O-E-H-L, or 919-995-0550.
Thank you, Tom. Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill is a global architectural, urban planning, and engineering firm founded in Chicago by architects Louis Skidmore, Nathaniel Owings, and engineer John Merrill. It has offices all over the world and a portfolio of projects across 50 countries with some 2,000 awards. In its heyday, from the 1950s through the 1990s, it was the Amazon of design firms, one of the largest in the world. Some projects you might know about include some of the world's tallest buildings, the 1973 Sears/Willis Tower in Chicago, and the 2010 Burj Khalifa in Dubai, international airport terminals in Chicago and Kansas City, Lever House, the 2013 World Trade Center, the new Penn Station, which is going in now, the Waldorf Astoria restoration in New York City, the Treasure Island redevelopment in San Francisco, the first net zero energy school in New York, and even the design of Moon Village, a concept for the first permanent lunar settlement.
Lunar settlement.
Yeah.
Just want to make sure I heard that right. Okay. Nick Adams is Mary Conover Mellon Professor Emeritus in the Art Department at Vassar College, where he taught the history of architecture from 1989 till 2018. Prior to teaching at Vassar, he taught at Lehigh University for 11 years. He was also at McGill University, UCLA, Columbia, and the Graduate School of Design at Harvard University. He is the author of Gordon Bunshaft and SOM, Building Corporate Modernism. Nick previously wrote the first independently authored study of Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill, the SOM that we're talking about, back in 2007. Nick explores the conflict between Bunshaft's ambition for acclaim and the collaborative structure of SOM's culture.
Also joining us is Kate Regev, architect and architectural historian and design writer. She's written extensively for Dwell and taught historic preservation at Columbia. With two master's degrees, Kate speaks five languages, including Catalan. It's a tiny area of northeastern Spain. And her Pinterest boards include wedding hair and door handles. We discover that her many well-written and popular articles in Dwell almost always have a number, like 19 laudable mid-century modern renovations in Los Angeles, 5 prefab home companies to know in Illinois, 14 best mid-century renovations in San Francisco, and 29 granny flats that put guests up in style. Welcome, Kate.
Thanks. Thanks for having me.
SOM is a company that is not as large now as it used to be, I understand. I looked up the top 100 firms and didn't see it in there. Nick, was it a lot larger back in the heyday?
Well, I think it was larger in relation to many other firms. It certainly had, at one point, about 2,000 employees. But, you know, technology has changed the way we practice architecture, and SOM is not as large as it once was. I couldn't tell you exactly what the current employee amount is, but it changes and expands as it needs to.
During the 50s and 60s, particularly, SOM was really the rock star of the architectural world. It was not only building great designs, but it also was financially successful.
It had enormous success in the 1950s and early 60s, and a success that was really across the board. That is to say, with clients, with experts, and with the public. And this really starts with Lieberhaus in 1952 and runs well into the 60s. There was complaints from certain magazines that when SOM approached them about a new building, they would complain, but the whole magazine could be filled with SOM buildings. They were building that much, and the enthusiasm around them was that great.
Kind of like Bjork Ingels is now.
Scale is a little different, but yes.
Yeah. So how did you start studying and following the SOM trajectory?
Well, this is a story of happenstance. If you went back a little farther in my CV, you would see that I, in fact, started as a scholar of the Italian Renaissance, and my early work was on the town of Siena and its military architecture. I later worked on large Renaissance architectural firms, Antonio da San Gallo and St. Peter's, and as a result of that, I was familiar with and started writing for Casabella, and through that magazine, which is edited in Milan, I got to know their editor, Francesco Dalco. One morning, I was sitting in my country house, which is the only house I have, I should add, so better expressed as my house in the country, and the phone rings, and it's Francesco, who says, "Why don't you write a book about SOM?" And I confessed to astonishment. I said, "But I don't know anything about SOM more than other people." And he said, "No, go down and go see David Childs, who was then the chairman, and David will fill you in." I was at one of those flexion points in my career, and I said, "Well, why not?" And I went down and talked with David Childs, who made an enormous effort to introduce me to all sides of the firm, with the result that this book, which came out in 2006 and 2007 on Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill, which is a book which highlights 26 of their major projects, includes an introductory essay. The result of that was that I became something of an expert in this very large firm and its many buildings. Nobody else had bothered to follow one firm, understandably. Not that firm, not in those years, because the periods of the 90s and the early 2000s was not necessarily the best period of SOM's history. So it was really happenstance and being able to speak Italian to the person who wanted to talk to me about a book.
Now, Kate, besides speaking Italian, which I think is on your list, right?
Man, you guys have done some deep digging, haven't you?
Oh, yes. Our guest research department is unparalleled.
Crack. Yes.
So how did you get exposed to SOM? When did you first start looking at their buildings and the personalities behind them?
Well, you know, SOM is kind of, one of the biggest names in architecture. And so as a practicing architect, you know, I learned about them in school. And then also, you know, as a preservationist, their buildings have become increasingly under the preservationist's eye, too, as these mid-century buildings have become centers of a lot of preservation controversy in the past decade or two. But Nathalie Dubois specifically, I became really interested in her because while I was in graduate school at Columbia, I started doing research on some of the school's early female architects. The school started accepting women into its architecture program around 1910, and Nathalie went to school there in the 40s, so she was kind of on the tail end of the period that I was looking at. But I started looking into the work that some of these women had done, and she, you know, is a star, basically, and had not really been talked about very much at that point. So that's kind of how I became interested in her story and her work.
And tell us about how Nathalie figures into the SOM time frame.
Well, so she started at SOM in the 40s, and so this is kind of, you know, some of their earliest work. And so she served on the design team for a number of kind of their up-and-coming, really exciting projects. So she was a design coordinator for the Lever House. She worked on the Connecticut General Life Insurance Company headquarters out in Bloomfield, Connecticut, also in the 1950s. And then in the 60s is really kind of when I think SOM, and I'm sure Nick can speak more to this, that's really when kind of SOM becomes the SOM that we know today. And when they started constructing these really famous glass skyscrapers that we see in New York that line Park Avenue. And so she was a senior designer for several of those buildings, and that was one of her major contributions to the city.
What made the Lever building so special?
Well, so Lever House really is one of those kind of spectacular mid-century skyscrapers in New York. It was completed in 1952, I think, and it's built in the international style. So it was kind of one of those first curtain wall skyscrapers in New York and became kind of an icon for the glassy skyscraper prototype.
This is where all the madmen would go to work.
Oh, really?
Essentially, yes.
Okay. Nick, let's draw back a little bit. Tell us about Gordon Bunshaft and how he came into the firm, because he wasn't one of the founders.
No, not at all. He's born in 1909 in Buffalo, New York. His father was an egg merchant, sold cracked and broke eggs, and sent the yolks and whites off to bakeries and the like. He comes from a very humble family. They were immigrants from the Ukraine. They'd come just a few years before he was born. He is a person of decision and clarity in his wishes and desires. And at an early age, a doctor comes to visit him, and he says, "You ought to be an architect." And he, as a young man, decides he will be an architect. His violin teacher has two sons who go to MIT, and he decides at that moment he will go to MIT. Indeed, he does.
So violin teachers and doctors are the people who are steering his life early on.
His father isn't going to offer that quite the direction that you'd want. And he looked to those people that he respected, the professionals around him, as people do. So absolutely. So that's how he ends up at MIT. He wins a notable prize there. He graduates from MIT. He has a bachelor's and a master's degree. His father supports him through that period. And when he comes back, he works briefly in Buffalo, then briefly for Edward Durell Stone, the architect in New York. And when Stone's business hits the rocks, he shifts over to Lewis Skidmore. He works for Skidmore and Owings, basically around the time of the New York World's Fair of 1939. So that's really his introduction. And he proves there that he's tougher, has sharper elbows, and can control a situation better than anybody else. We have stories that he's sent to work on a design project as a designer with four or five others, some of them older men than him. And he's told that he's to be in charge, but they're not told that. And he manages to impose himself on them. And that ability both to impose his ideas, well, let's start from the beginning, to have an idea, and then to impose it and to organize the men and women to work with him was his extraordinary skill. So starting in 39, he has a prominent place within the firm.
What was his breakthrough project? Was it Lever in 52 or was it earlier?
Well, it's hard to say. When we're talking about his project and quite what that means, that's maybe a subject you want to talk about later, but he has some very important buildings prior to Lever House, including Manhattan House up on 66th Street, which is a splendid, marvelous piece of urban planning which he's involved with. You have the Fort Hamilton Veterans Administration Hospital out in Brooklyn from about 51, which is superb piece of siting and design, extremely original. But it's 52 with Lever House that he really breaks through into public consciousness, in which he grabs the headlines. And grabs is the appropriate word. The building, as already described by Kate, is a critical glass-covered structure. But its novelty was that it was glass in a street of stone and brick. And it made open space, bringing light down to the lower part of the city. It's basically a square donut with a slab set at right angles to Park Avenue, so right angles to the main street. And the idea was to bring light and air into the center of the city to create this modern image of business. And in that, it was supremely successful. Bunshaft's particular contribution to this would be a longer subject. But he rode its success. The accolades he received from that building lasted him a lifetime. And it lasted him both for the public, but also within the firm. So that when the question of how or what should be done came up, when Gordon said, do it this way, people followed him. So he had a reputation not just outside, but also inside the firm, so that when there were questions of how to build something in San Francisco, you asked Gordon Bunshaft in New York. Or when there was a question of how to build something in Chicago, like Inland Steel, which is the great building of the mid-century, one of the finest pieces of modernism, Gordon Bunshaft was involved and had a determinative effect on it. Or when Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill was hired to do the Air Force Academy in Colorado, even though the name Walter Netsch is attached to every part of it, who was the Chicago partner in charge, Gordon Bunshaft was there. He went out to Chicago, he directed things there, and he was welcomed for that contribution that he made. So
he was a big picture kind of designer, yes. Project manager type?
Yes, although, I mean, big picture in the sense that he, if you brought the problem to him and he was involved in the making of the program, he would provide the series of alternatives that the designers under him would work on, yes. He always believed in having a big idea, and people report that not only was that what he had big ideas, but he, in a sense, didn't believe that a design should continue without a big idea.
Kate, let's go back to Natalie Dubois, who was involved with the Lever building early on and gets a lot of credit for putting that together. What was her life like as a female architect at this time?
So actually, Natalie had, she was originally from New Jersey, and the reason why she got interested in architecture was largely through her father, who was a civil engineer. And so growing up, you know, she occasionally, I think, would visit New York City. But so there were a few moments that were pretty impactful on her life, and one of them was seeing the World's Fair in New York City in 1939. But unfortunately, soon after that, because of the Great Depression, when she was of age to go to college, a lot of the more expensive universities or colleges that she was interested in, that wasn't an option really because of the financial requirements. So instead, she went to a small women's college out west. It was the Western College for Women in Oxford, Ohio. But she was actually only there for a year because Colombia, in I think 1940 or 41, changed its rules and said that because of the draft and the end of the Depression, that they were now going to accept students, including women who had only 1 year of college from another school, and then they could transfer over to Columbia. So initially, she really wanted to go to MIT, but it ended up being Columbia instead. So after she graduated, and even while she was in school, she was working for a few small firms, and she actually ended up at SOM because of an uncomfortable situation at the office where she had been working. Immediately after school, she started working for a small firm, Ketchum, Gina, and Sharp, but she was not interested in one of her colleagues, her male colleagues, who kept asking her out and kept trying to go out with her, and she wasn't interested. So because she rebuffed him, he went to Morris Ketchum, one of the principals of the firm, who said, okay, and basically had her leave, but did her the favor of calling down to SOM, who at the time had a really small office in the same building. And basically that same day, she started working down there.
What a weird way for that to play out. That's
what
a time.
We hope that that wouldn't happen today. But I think that that kind of speaks, you know, that subtlety kind of speaks to the rest of her career and, you know, the way it was for women working in architecture at the time. The funny thing is that her class at Columbia had 5 other women in it out of a class of 18. So the class was pretty small because it was in the middle of World War II.
Yeah.
But she actually is one of the only women from her class who went on to have a long and extremely prominent career. And a lot of that was because of her talent. I mean, she started at SOM, and really quickly it was realized that she was an extremely talented designer, and she basically hit the ground running.
And how did she get into the Leverhaus project?
My understanding is that she had already been at the firm for about 5 or 6 years at that time. No, probably a little more. But she mainly was working on the design side. And so, you know, she had started working on some other smaller buildings and smaller projects. And then maybe Nick has more information about how she specifically started working on the Leverhaus. But, you know, she was working on other modernist buildings before then. And, you know, that I think was maybe 6 or 7 years into her career there.
Now, Nick, I understand that you met Natalie.
Oh, sure.
So what was she like?
Very difficult.
Yeah?
We need to go back a bit.
Yeah.
Natalie and Gordon got along extremely well, in part because she valued his clarity. This is a difficult man who speaks his opinion. So he was clear and direct in all things. If he didn't like what he saw, he told you, and you moved forward from there. And Natalie had much of that same characteristic. I mean, I worked with her on preparing a list of her buildings, which we published in the SOM Journal, and so have some sense of how this was. And if I made a mistake or proposed something, she would just look at me and say, no, that's not right. And we move forward. Now, Gordon, it does need to be said that Gordon basically got what he wanted at every point. That was the principle under which SOM worked and the terms under which she worked for him. What turns out to be very interesting to me in her career is that Gordon advanced her professionally in significant ways. There are stories of him being dismissive of her, as of many other people. I mean, he didn't pick out her to be dismissive towards. But also, she credited him with advancing her career and advancing her professional status. She did not get that same treatment when she moved to Chicago. And Bruce Graham turned out to be, who was in Chicago, turned in the Chicago office of SOM, turned out to be particularly difficult for her, and Myron Goldsmith. So it's not a simple story of someone being given some kind of special treatment at SOM or even a distinctive treatment. She was included along with the other senior designers. She obviously met his needs perfectly. He selected her over and over again. I think there are dozens of projects that she worked on with him, and he valued her contribution. Attempted to advance her professionally, helped her move forward. That he was difficult for her, I understand. The ways in which they were really similar is that if you look at the way in which Gordon speaks about his buildings, he never really says very much about them. If you ask him about why he did a certain thing, and you can see this in the interviews that have been published, he'll say, well, we did that because it was the most practical thing to do, or we did that because the program demanded that we do it, or we did that because it's what the client wanted and we thought it was the right thing. And I found, talking to Natalie, she said the same things. When I would ask her, well, why did such and such happen on the Corning Glass sales building, which was one of the buildings she worked on before Lever, she would say, it was the logical thing to do. It was what you did. So she answered with the same kind of clarity, not giving you away a lot, but the same kind of clarity that he did. And I think they must have seen eye to eye on many of the ways in which a building got put together.
So neither she nor Gordon went into those kind of esoteric explanations that sometimes architects can do.
Never.
It was more like, you know, the client told us.
Yeah, Or
my gut told me.
Yeah.
I don't think he ever got that far down.
Okay.
My
this is the way it had
me.
To be. This was the logical way to do it. We looked at our choices. And by the way, I should say that with SOM building, it is extremely hard to find alternatives for anything that they did. I mean, I was able to find a number of alternatives for one project, but it's by sheer chance. In most cases, we don't know what they thought of as they were producing it. These buildings look like they came down from the sky. They look like they're made in the factory. You know, and Lever, if you just want to take one example, is I would say, yes, it was the most important building for Gordon Bunshaft, but we need to understand that the parterre, the form that the building took, that square donut with the slab rising from it, was a design that was invented by Nat Owings in 1947 in Chicago, and for Chicago building. And the turning of the building at right angles to the street was the idea of Nat Owings. And Gordon says so. And the idea that they should follow the UN Secretariat building was an idea that came from Owings and from Skidmore that Gordon followed. The way in which the glass attached to the wall of the building, that is how you got the glass to stay there and the templates that hold it in, was the work of Wayne Sovereigns, who was in the production department at SOM. So when we talk about a building being put together, we like to have these names to attach to it because it makes it clear that there's an author artist. But in fact, they're the product of a group of people. And
hundreds of people.
And that group is one of the things I tried to bring out in my book was, who was that group? What did they contribute? What did each one offer? It's not as clear as we'd like it, that story about who was responsible or who did such and such a building.
Kate, the Lever building is now almost 70 years old. Is it doing okay? Have there been any scares of having it be torn down or turned into an Italianate villa or some other horrible fate?
Well, so actually, you don't need to worry about, you know, an Italian villa coming to the Lever House because it's a designated New York City landmark. And so it's an individual landmark, and it has been since the early 80s.
Like the Chrysler Building, for instance.
Mm-hmm, right. And so what that means in New York City is that you cannot alter the exterior of the building without going through the Landmarks Preservation Commission's requirements that might include public presentations, reviews of, you know, whatever your proposed changes might be.
A horrible process no one wants to go through.
it can be excruciating, but it helps ensure that the exterior and the public-facing parts of these iconic buildings remains for the public to enjoy and to see, I mean, to appreciate. But, you know, as you mentioned, the building is 70 years old, and 70-year-old glass is not nearly as energy efficient as what we can have today. And so, like many other mid-century buildings, the building actually has gone under a major renovation of a lot of its exterior panels and its glazing. One of the things, though, that it's known for is its kind of greenish-tinted glass, which is really typical of the era because of the chemical components of the glazing itself. And so when the building was restored, I think it was probably in the early 2000s, you know, that was one thing that everyone wanted to make sure stayed the same, that iconic color of the glass, that greenness that would stay.
Like Ray-Ban sunglasses.
Exactly.
Are those green? I guess that those come in every color.
Yeah, well,
it's a style.
Some of them are.
Kate, you tell an interesting story about Lieberhaus. I don't know whether you were going to take that forward to suggest that it wasn't exactly the green that we had before.
Well, you know, I have not looked extensively into the restoration of the building's curtain wall, but my understanding was that over the years, a lot of panels had been replaced.
Oh, yes.
And so that kind of gave it almost a checkerboard appearance, and the desire when the whole building was restored was that it would go back to that green-tinted glass. Whether or not, you know, the tone is slightly different, I'm not entirely sure, but that was part of the desired appearance.
But one of the problems, just to take up on this question of renovation, is we're actually beginning to lose a lot of these buildings. So a number of Bunchef buildings have been lost, whether it's Emhart Building out next to Connecticut General. Union Carbide is coming down now.
As we speak.
The renovation of the Albright Knox Gallery will destroy what was the effect of the old and the new buildings in contrast. The Diller and Scofidio additions to Lincoln Center have not, it seems to me, improved the experience of Henry Moore's sculpture in front of the theater. And the manufacturer's renovation, while it's preserved the exterior, the interior is basically gone. And so much of the experience of that building was on the interior. What's the problem here? Is it just energy efficiency, or is it scale, or?
Well, I know for 270 Park Avenue, so that's the old Union Carbide building, that actually is a fascinating story because it is absolutely not about energy savings. It's all about size and the scale of what you're allowed to build today versus back then. Actually, the Union Carbide building, you know, at 270 Park Avenue, in 2012 underwent a huge renovation that made it LEED certified. And it was one of the largest buildings to complete that level of LEED renovation. So it's less so about energy savings there and really just that J.P. Morgan Chase needs a bigger building, they say. So they're demolishing the existing building so that they can bigger and even larger headquarters there.
When we get back in just a moment, we're going to follow up on some of the projects of SOM in the 50s and 60s.
Beauty, love, durability, designed to last for years to come. Bringing you peace and tranquility. You feel relaxed, knowing your house can easily achieve any exterior look and any color. Wood, concrete. Your house loves feeling this good. And you love feeling this good. Nichia, 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 Nichia. Say it with me. Nichia. Advanced engineering. Nichia. Nichia. Durability. Textures. Finishes. And colors. Visit nichia.com/US Modernist. Nichia. 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 That's N. I. C.
It's very meditative, don't you think? Yeah. Very meditative. Okay, we're back. And SOM continued its influential modernist work in 1954 with the Manufacturers Trust Company building, which was the first international-style bank. But I want to fast forward a little further to the 1960 Pepsi building, which was called the Ultimate in Refinement of Proportion and Elegance of Materials. Nick, what can you tell us about that building?
Well, It is one of, for those people that like a lovely, refined, and beautifully arranged curtain wall, this is it. It's a delicate structure just above on 59th Street. It's a small building, and so it has attracted more than its share, well, especially because you can kind of see it up close and be there with it. It is exquisitely set because the architects have placed along the side where it meets the neighboring buildings a strip of black marble, which separates the building out from those around it. It's 9 stories, come to think of it. And then, by the way, also moved all the services out towards the neighboring buildings so they don't interfere in any way with your experience of the building. So when you stand back and look at it, it's a lantern at night, and one of the most exquisite of SOM buildings. The key person in the design of the curtain wall was a man by the name of Herman Borst, and Herman lives in Mamaroneck, New York, and it's one of those things, you know, extraordinary experience to talk with somebody about their building. He's now well in his 90s, about how it was put together, about the pleasures of being together, and what was done. So it's one of those buildings that just simply sits there and floats above the street.
Nick, how did Bunshaft feel about postmodernism when that came along?
Hated it.
Yeah?
Hated it. He had a number of difficult exchanges over these buildings. In the 1960s, he served on the Commission of Fine Arts in Washington, and a building by Robert Venturi came up before the Commission of Fine Arts, and he could not have been more scathing. I guess this is a family show, so I can't report exactly what he said.
We'll bleep it. You can go ahead, though.
Okay. Well, there's a famous or infamous incident when a young designer came to New York from Washington, and he met Gordon, who had then retired from the firm but was sitting in the offices working over his slides. And the young man came over to him and said, "I'd like to introduce myself. I, of course, know about your work. I'm very honored to meet you." And Bunshaft, without looking up, said, "Oh, yeah?" He said, "How long have you been with the firm?" He said, "Well, I've only been here for so long." And he says, "Where do you come from?" He says, "Washington. I came up from the Washington office." And Bunshaft, without even looking up, said, "I suppose you do that postmodernist shit." So there was no love. He felt that it was a betrayal of modernism, as many architects did. He wasn't unique in this feeling. I mean, I once had an exchange with John Johansson not far from here, and I thought John Johansson was going to have an apoplectic fit when I mentioned the name of Philip Johnson, who was a proponent of postmodernism. And so that the use of historical sources, the direct use of historical sources, was thought to be really a subversion of what architecture should be about.
So here's a toss-up question for either of you. As far as our crack research team has been able to determine, Gordon Bunshaft and SOM together only designed one house, and that was Gordon's own house in the Hamptons called the Travertine House. Is that right?
That is right. I mean, only one private house.
Yes, one private house.
Right.
And it became the Architectural Record House of 1966. He left it in his will, I guess, to the Museum of Modern Art, which sold it to Martha Stewart.
Martha Stewart?
Yes. And she extensively remodeled it. It was gutted. Then it was stalled. Then it was abandoned for years amid a neighbor dispute. In 2004, she transferred the property to her daughter, Alexis. And then Alexis sold it. And
Marie Presley bought it?
I don't think so. And then it was destroyed in 2004. I guess my question here to either of you is, we've heard this was called the Travertine House because it had a lot of travertine stone in it, but that travertine stone is still MIA. It's missing somewhere. It's like the lost Ark of the Covenant. Any idea where that ended up?
It's like it didn't go to the landfill.
No, it did not.
No.
I can't help you. I know that some of the flooring from that house was, so I've been told, taken by Martha Stewart and used in her one of her other houses, but I don't know what's happened to the travertine.
Do you know, Kate?
I don't know, but I can tell you a lot of the times when people say that something disappeared from the construction site, it went into the landfill. So if I had to take my best guess, that's where I would think it would be.
Mm. This sounds like a good Dwell investigative article. What happened to the travertine?
Yeah. On your way to finding Jimmy Hoffa.
There was that recent effort that people have discovered the pieces of Frank Lloyd Wright's Larkin Building. We've always thought that the Larkin Building was completely destroyed in Buffalo, but in fact there are ruins around. Unfortunately, however, this is all private land, so, you know, good luck.
Yeah, you can't go bumbling around there.
Yeah.
Kate, in reading about Natalie and Norma Sklarik and others, it seemed like when you had a man who was decisive and ambitious, he was a leader. But when you had a woman who was decisive and ambitious, she was kind of a bitch at that time. Is that the experience that you see of reading about these women? They were just treated differently?
Well, you know, it's a little tricky. A lot of the time, these women were not necessarily in the situation that you just described because they were an exception to the rule. And so a lot of the time, they felt like they just had to kind of fall in line, and by falling in line, they weren't treated as something different. I mean, for Norma Sklarik, for example, though, her case was quite different. Funnily enough, you know, she did work at SOM for, I think, about 4 or 5 years in the early 50s, but because she was African-American, that often was just as big of an issue for her finding jobs and making her way forward in her career as was being a woman. You know, it's kind of a double whammy for her. So a lot of women often went into practice with their husbands, often, you know, men that they had met in graduate school, kind of as a way to avoid the complexities of working in these major
All-male firms, pretty much.
Yeah, all-male firms. And, you know, what we didn't even mention yet, actually, was that Natalie had 4 children. She had 4 boys while she was living in New York in her tenure at SOM's New York office. And we can only imagine how difficult that must have been to balance the long hours that she would have to spend in the office with having 4 children at home.
Oh, boys raise themselves. I don't know what you're talking about.
Say 3 men on the phone.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah,
right.
2. I didn't say it.
No. Bingo.
Nick and Kate both, are there any SOM buildings right now anywhere in the country that are endangered we should alert the public about?
Well, I think Connecticut General is always in trouble and has been under threat. I mean, certainly from this period, that's the one. It was salvaged 10 years ago. With a movement that came from Yale, but I think they decided to keep it. You can't get into the building, and that's always a bad sign.
Right. It's owned by Cigna now, I think. Is that right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they're not keen for people to see it. You know, the reality is there are lots as you go around. So, for example, the YF laboratories in Radnor, Pennsylvania are empty. So whatever happens to those, I don't know. There are a whole bunch of smaller buildings that have been taken down. The Heinz buildings in Pittsburgh have been, in some cases, taken over and are being renovated. I think the laboratory is being renovated for an apartment building, and that's being done well. But I think some of the smaller buildings, I mean, the cafeterias and things like that are gone. There are the hospitals that are up through upstate New York, which were done by Gordon with Natalie as a senior designer on some cases that are in really tough shape. I mean, if any money came into Alexandria Bay, I'm sure they'd take it down in a second. Dartmouth College just took down the Kiewit Computer Center. We need to stay alert to these things. The Hirshhorn is about to undergo a major renovation, which is a great thing.
In Washington,
but,
yes.
But in Washington, D.C., but people like Kate will have to be keeping their eyes open for what happens because those buildings need to be protected. And just as an example of the kind of casual ways things get changed, in the Washington Metro, they decided that they'd paint the walls not that long ago to brighten them up. Well, if you paint concrete, that's the end of it. You know, the concrete surfaces will no longer show through. So
that's horrible.
It is something that I may be forgetting some that are there, but you know, I think one has to be vigilant and recognize that buildings need to be used. They obviously, we can't just keep these buildings empty. But
if you can't get to Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, for the National Commercial Bank, which is a great building, you can see the Lever House at Park Avenue and 52nd. You can see the 9 West 57th Street building in New York. You can also see 140 Broadway with its Noguchi sculpture, or the Beinecke Library at Yale University. There's the American Republic Insurance Building in Des Moines, Iowa, and the LBJ Library and Museum in Austin are also quite spectacular. Kate and Nick, thank you so much for joining us. It's really a pleasure to have you on the show.
You're very welcome.
Thanks so much for having us.
And if you want to see more about the Travertine House and maybe solve the mystery of where that all went to, you can go to usmodernist.org/bunshaft, B-U-N-S-H-A-F-T. All right. Dropping by the studio, it's one of my favorite jazz vocalists, Valerie Wood, with two romantic mid-century tunes you all know and probably love. First, It Had to Be You was written in 1924 and first got famous starting in the 1940s in dozens of films, including Casablanca and later Annie Hall and A League of Their Own. More recently, you've heard it by Frank Sinatra, Michael Bublé, and most famously, in When Harry Met Sally by Harry Connick Jr. It's consistently rated as one of the top tunes in U.S. movies. Here's Valerie Wood with It Had to Be You.
It had to be you. It had to be you. I wandered around and finally found somebody who could make me be true, make me be blue, and even be glad just to be sad thinking of you. Some others I've seen might never be mean, might never be cross or try to be boss, but they wouldn't do for nobody else. Gives me that thrill. With all your thoughts, I love you still. It had to be you, wonderful you. It had to be you.
Wow, that was lovely. Thank you, Valerie.
Sure.
So this is making part of my Ally McBeal fantasy come true. If you recall from that series, they all had that law office, and in the first floor was the bar with the singer who would come on at the end and sing tunes.
Vonda Shepherd.
Vonda Shepherd, who did Search in My Soul. I think that was her big hit that came out of that, right?
Right.
And so now we do these shows, and you come on, and it's like Ally McBeal. It's just really wonderful.
She's got that nice raspy voice.
She does. She does indeed. And she's still performing all around everywhere.
That's wonderful.
We're going to hear next Fly Me to the Moon, which was written in 1954. Kay Ballard, who we just lost last year, made the first recording in the late 50s, but Frank Sinatra's version has always been the gold standard. It's been covered by everyone from Johnny Mathis to Nancy Wilson to Peggy Lee to Edie Gourmet, and more than 300 versions. My favorite version, until now, was by Diana Krall, who sang at the Apollo 11 40th Anniversary Celebration Ceremony, and also for Neil Armstrong's memorial in 2012. Here's Valerie with Fly Me to the Moon.
See what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing.
Wow, thank you. And thanks for listening. Among other destinations, U.S. Modernist takes architecture fans to Europe, Washington, Palm Springs, and Dubai with adventures in architecture at usmodernist.org/tours, proceeds of which underwrite our documentation and preservation programs. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by Angela Roll, your special real estate agent for Modernist Houses, and by Nichiha.com/US Modernist. Okay, Tom, take us out.
U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Modernist Archive, a nonprofit educational archive for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. We record at Soundtracks Recording Studios in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song is performed by George Smart and Robinson Earl. She Who Cannot Be Named conducts our guest research in seclusion with her two grandchildren, Gloop and Gleep.
Finally, we work in a Herculoids reference.
I guess so. Visit usmodernist.org's massive modernist archives to hear past shows, discover 7,000 mid-century houses, and access 2.7 million pages of classic 20th century architecture magazines. Plus, you can get on our newsletter list for exciting modernist tours. Contact George at george@usmodernist.org or on Instagram at mr.modernism. George and I'll be back soon with another well-masked, contextually relevant International House of Architecture edition of U.S. Modernist Radio.